Mine Your Business is a tricky spatial puzzle about mining gnomes that features many modes of play, including solo, cooperative, and competitive versions. While it wasn't quite what we expected, we think some folks will dig it, especially if they like spatial puzzles.
The Mine Your Business was designed by Gavi Neftali and features artwork by Art Casey. It was originally funded on Kickstarter back in October 2022 by then brand new publisher NV Borden Games. This was their first game. It is now available in retail and through most online stores. Now, there are two different boxes for this game. The only difference between them are the colors of the pieces. Alone, each set plays one or two players, or you can buy both to play with three or four.
The game of Mine Your Business can be rather quick or can go quite long, which really depends on how much time the players spend thinking. It's listed as ages 12 plus, but it should work with younger players as the basic mechanics are not complicated and there's minimum reading required.
So in Mine Your Business, the mine in question is represented by a grid of square cards. Each gnome has a mine card at the edge of the grid that moves clockwise around the board. Each turn, the gnomes will be moving around the mine, manipulating the cards in an attempt to load chains of matching resources. Competitive gnomes are just trying to outdo each other, but when working solo or cooperatively, they also have to deal with the nasty goblins. Who are also wandering the mine and eating up resources and any gnomes they catch.
For a look at the components you get in both versions of this game, check out our Mine Your Business unboxing video on YouTube.
Now, overall, I found the component quality here to be a little mixed. The wooden silkscreen gnomes and goblins look fantastic, and what I really appreciated, they actually showed the back and front artwork on the two sides. Though I gotta say, those are the strangest looking goblins I've ever seen. Card quality's good, rulebook's clear and well-organized. The problem, though, is the brightness and contrast on the cards themselves. They're overly dark and rather uniform in color. And I honestly don't think this was intentional. They look like the kind of thing that looked great on a screen, but once it came from the printer, it came out darker than intended.
Even in phone photographs, which generally improve the look of such things, it was obvious how the contrast was not ideal. For now, though, let's give everyone a quick overview of how to play Mine Your Business. Starting with the basic two-player game.
So start by building a 4x4 mine out of cards and place a cart for each player at opposite ends. Place the gnomes in front of each cart. Each card features 1 to 3 types of mine shafts or resources on them. There's gold, gems, and coal. Now these shafts follow various paths. Like some cards just have a single curve, others have two curves. Some go straight through, there's dead ends and crosses. What you won't find, though, is ever any type of branching path, no splits or T-intersections.
Each turn starts with the active player taking up to 3 actions. You can move an adjacent card, you can rotate the card you are on, you can swap the card you are on with one next to it, you can do any of those 3 actions to a campfire card as if you were standing on it, or you can load your cart.
Yeah, the only wonky one there, it's all really simple, is the campfires. These are certain cards that have a campfire on them that let you manipulate them as if you're on top of them, which is the one thing that takes a bit to get used to. Now, loading chains of resources is the goal of the game. When loading, you get to collect all of the cards that form a continuous path of the same resource, forming a chain going to your mine cart off the map. Think of basically all the pipe puzzle apps out there where you're trying to connect the one end to the other.
After taking your actions, if your gnome is on a card with a signpost, you get to do the action there, which could involve swapping or turning your cards, moving your gnome, getting a free load action, or whatever.
Next, board's refilled. Your mine cart moves clockwise 1 card around the map. Game continues until either the mine cart deck runs out, which we've never actually seen, or the player's carts go off the opposite side of the map.
While this is going, players have 3 special ability cards they can use once per game each. Teleport lets them move their gnome and the card it's on to the space in front of their cart. Lunchtime lets them take extra actions, and the emergency break stops their minecart from moving.
Now, I don't know what it's saying about gnomes that when they take lunchtime, they work extra hard. I thought that was an interesting choice. Now, at the end of the game, players count up how many cards they collected. That simple. The gnome with the most mine cards wins. Now, to add some weight to the game, there is a resource scoring variant that I recommend any hobby gamers use, potentially on your first game. This gives each type of resource a random value based on a deck of cards. So in that particular game, it might be that the gems are worth the most and coal's almost worth nothing.
Well, that's the basic two-player game. You can also play Mine Your Business solo through a short 3-part campaign. The first part adds rules for encounters. The second adds a nasty goblin to the mine. And the last adds a mine owner along with his pet goblin. The goal in all of these is to collect at least 30 cards and not get gobbled by a goblin.
Now you can also play Mind Your Business cooperatively with 2 to 4 players. Playing this way, the players share a single mine cart, which they have to work together to load. Now, to make things interesting, they'll also have to deal with 1 or 2 goblins based on the player count.
And that's it. Nothing too complex to the game, but a nice number of variants to try.
Now, Deanna and I discovered Mind Your Business at Origins Game Fair, where it was one of those games where when I saw it set up on the demo table, I just looked at it and went, I know what this game is about. There's a grid and it's got paths on it and there's a mine cart. And obviously you have to make paths match, right? Yeah, you have to make the mine cards match to the cart and then you get points, right? And honestly, that's what the game basically is. But what I didn't expect is how difficult it is and how hard it is to actually get those cards lined up the way you want. Like, I personally had visions of moving and flipping and turning cards to set up these big combos where I load half the board onto my cart and feel smart. I expected to be looking ahead as well and trying to set things up so not only do I load a bunch of stuff now, but I've also set myself up for the future. Now, while there is some of that in the game, and now and then you can pull off a big combo, in general, though, there just aren't enough actions to do what it would take to pull this off. With only 3 actions a turn, you don't manipulate the board much, and loading is one of those actions. So in general, you get to do 2 things before you load it, which on many turns are going to be I move, I rotate, I load. I move, I swap, I load. I swap, I move, I load. And that's kind of it. Like, you're just not doing a lot of stuff. And most of the time, you're probably going to load only about 3 cards. And that's if you planned ahead. Sometimes you're just going to load 1. With this limited action economy, pulling off a big combo ends up becoming more a matter of luck than skill. And that disappointed me quite a bit.
Yeah, it is unquestionably a puzzle game. And that alone may have some people just taking on, moving on.
Now, for people who like puzzles, that limited number of actions does make this game hard. And it makes it really rewarding, though, when you can do that planning ahead. Because it took me a bit to realize you don't necessarily want to load your card every turn. Totally ignoring where your card is and what you're going to get now to set up a big combo later, 2, 3, 4, maybe even 5, 10 turns ahead, can be a better way to play. And when you do manage to pull off that move around the corner after your mine cards finally made a turn and you load 8, 9 cards, that feels great.
Yeah, a downfall to the strategic depth, however, is potential analysis paralysis on the part of the players. With a big grid of cards in front of you and that need to plan for future turns, players can be overwhelmed with potential, which is fine and may even be ideal for a solo game, but can be awkward in a game of 2 or more players where the balance of how much time people are taking is not matching.
So because of this limitation, to me, this very much fits our list of surprisingly complex games, which is something we originally shared back on episode 103 of the podcast. This shocked me by how difficult it is to actually play well. The colorful artwork, silly looking gnomes and tone of the game made me think it was going to be more of a quick, silly game, not the deep thinker it is, where at least when all players take the game very seriously.
Yeah, I'm actually on the fence about this, as I'm not sure if it's really that complex or if it's just the sheer number of options, or if the number of options is what makes it complex. Yeah. I do know that Board Game Geek users haven't managed to figure out its complexity yet either. Despite having a number of ratings, no one's bothered to no one's figured out what to put in as a weight yet.
There you go. That's slightly amusing. Now, another thing I just want to bring it back up now that we're sharing our thoughts is the artwork. While the box covers are pretty bright with cute looking gnomes and colorful gems and kind of whimsical, the card artwork is dull with low contrast. Now, this is terrible on the backs of the cards, which thankfully isn't that big a deal and doesn't impact play. But you're going to be sitting there looking at the back of your lunch card going, what am I even looking at? Where it does affect the game, though, is on the cards with signposts. This is where, to me, it's a problem. They are hard to read for no reason. That could have been, I don't even know, big, bold letters, iconography, something. I find in most cases when a new signpost card comes up, players have to pick them up and read them, which in most games isn't a problem. But in this game, the problem is then they forget what orientation it was when they picked it up.
Yeah, and this complaint is borne out by a number of comments on the Board Game Geek page. I have a suspicion that this is an issue with the published game, but isn't an issue with the print and play. This is going to be one of those, your files look different depending on the manner of printing. It probably right. looked great with all the test prints they did at home on whatever printers they used, but when they sent it off to the manufacturer, that different printing format on different cardstock gave us the results that have been somewhat problematic during the game.
Yeah, and I totally agree. This feels like a mistake, not something that was intentional. I don't think they were going for a darker and a mineshaft look here. I think this was a printing mistake. Hopefully something that can be improved if they ever do a second print run. Now, I enjoyed the basic game in Mind Your Business well enough, but what I was surprised to find is I actually like the cooperative version more. And one of the best parts of playing cooperative is the addition of the goblins. Now, one of the things is you're all working together on the same puzzle, which makes sense. But the goblin just had that silly random factor by having something to avoid, and it added a layer of fun that I felt was missing from the main game. Like throwing the goblin, there's that level of chaos and silliness that just manipulating cards as mines just didn't give it to me. Now, the other part is the fact that with the puzzle, you have more brains, right? So instead of just you trying to figure out that optimum move two turns from now to load eight cards, you now have two or three or four of you working on that same puzzle, which makes the puzzle both easier to solve and honestly more engaging because you're all talking about doing it. Now, that said, the problem potentially is because you're working on a puzzle cooperatively is quarterbacking. And that can very much be a problem in Mind Your Business when playing cooperatively. Heck, I've even seen it playing competitively when someone's like, oh, you missed the good move or you could have done this.
And it's understandable when you have a puzzle game like this. Some people are simply going to be more in tune with this style of puzzle, and whilst others will prefer a slower, more methodical style. And you're going to have conflict in that, even if you're playing a cooperative, non-conflict game. Yeah. Those different play styles are definitely going to butt heads.
Overall, Mind Your Business isn't quite what I expected, but ended up being enjoyable for what it is. Now, my one daughter really enjoys just the two-player experience. Two of us sitting down, no fancy rules, though we do throw in the market, the variable market. My other daughter wants the big four-player, but competitive only. She does not like cooperative. She wants the big four-player free-for-all. Overall, the other three of us, though, were like, oh, let's only play this cooperatively from now on. So, I don't know. It was good. We all enjoyed different aspects of it, and that's actually one of the things that I think is good about this game is there are those different variants and ways to play. If you like spatial puzzles, especially ones where it's about planning your moves multiple turns ahead, you'll probably enjoy Mind Your Business. It's probably worth picking up just for the solo experience, especially because of the neat short campaign with the onboarding and growing difficulty. But if you know one or more other people who also enjoy these kind of puzzles, this is probably a solid purchase. That way you can explore competitive and cooperative play modes as well as enjoy it as a single player experience.
Remember, though, that if you've got more than two people, you're going to need two copies to play with that three or four player count.
Yes, and in that case, pick up both different versions. That way you have different colored gnomes and the cards are actually differentiated so you can split them if you ever go back to playing solo or two player. Now, if what you want is a quick playing puzzle game, something like a phone app in board game form where you're going to twist and turn things to try to make an ultimate pathway that captures all the cards at once, you're not going to get that here. I actually expected Mind Your Business to be that. I thought it was going to be like the pipe puzzles that are out there, but this is not. The action economy is far too tight, and you don't get to manipulate the board enough for that style of play. Well, adding a house rule where you can load for free once a turn or something like that might fix that problem. We're here to review the game as published, and as published, it's a thinker.
It's a thinker, more like a crypto crossword than a word find. So gauge your interest in puzzles accordingly.
Now, for everyone in between, I recommend trying before you buy. Pick up a friend's copy, play it at a local gaming event, or check out the print and play version. You can get it at PNP Arcade at a much reduced price. That way you can try the game out and see if it's right for you, and hopefully your printer prints a little brighter than Envyborn's did.
Well, with that, we wrap up our review of Mind Your Business. a rather thinking puzzle game about mine collecting gems, gold, and coal with some funky looking goblins.
One of the best parts of Mine Your Business is the fact you can play it a number of ways, solo, cooperatively, competitively. I enjoy having these options in a game as long as they're fully detailed versions of the game and not some bolted on rule variant to make the game appeal to more people. And that's not that case here. These are all solid variants on different ways to play the game. What's a game with multiple modes of play you enjoy? One that does it right, as Mine Your Business does.
Well, let us know in the comments, or better yet, start up a thread on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord, which you can find at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.